As opposite to a number of other older cities of Denmark, the knowledge of the oldest history of Odense has for years been limited. During the last 5 to 10 years, this situation has changed, according to mainly two aspects. First of all, a series of detector sites around Odense have been revealed and shed new light on the background of Odense. Secondly, large rescue excavations, as well as a few self-funded research excavations in the old city center, have given new information on the foundation and structure of the oldest city. This presentation presents a research project that deals with this new material in an analysis of the urbanization process of Odense. The project is conducted by my colleague Mogens Bo Henriksen and myself, and financed by the research committee of the Danish Cultural Ministry. To start with the conclusion, I will in this presentation argue that Odense has a proto-city phase that starts about 200 years earlier than the traditional opinion. The background for this conclusion is new information on the date of erection of the Ringfort's Nonnebakken, new dating of the city's market activities and the indications of the permanency of these activities, and finally, newly found permanent settled houses from the 8th to 10th century. The area around Odense Fjord represents throughout the Iron Age a significant center of wealth, with detector sites in almost all naturally harbors. The picture illustrates that the area, until the emergence of Odense, was characterized by many centers or scattered central functions. A document from 988 marks the oldest written source in which Odense is mentioned. It tells about a church and a bishop in Odense. Whether this was absolutely true is discussed, but nevertheless it means that Odense had a certain size at the time. The document is called the Birth Certificate of Odense, but actually it indicates that Odense is older. The main cause for the former lack of knowledge about the oldest Odense is that a series of developers' projects were conducted in the first half of the 20th century, a period where the legislation in archaeology was totally different than it is today. Today the situation is better, and prior to an extensive development project in the city center, the museum has the opportunity to carry out excavations. As mentioned, the detector site and the excavations in the city forms the background for a research project with three focus points: dating of the emergence of Odense as a city, describing the early structure of the city, and analyzing the context for the formation of the city. The time span covered is approximately from 750 until 1101. The starting point corresponds with the oldest urban-like structures in the town, and the end date corresponds with King Canute made a saint, an event that marks a whole new situation for the development of Odense. The project combines typological studies and AMS datings on older collections with new excavations and place name studies. The theoretical model includes a dynamic perspective with criteria for urbanization varies across according to the situation of society. For the period 750 to 1000, we rely on, among others, Gray's definition, saying that a city must have a certain population density, a permanent settlement of a certain size, and that the majority of the inhabitants must work with crafts and trade. From 1000 and onwards, further criteria can be added. The ring fortress Nonnebakken is known from older maps, written sources and early excavations and stray finds, and has traditionally been seen as one of the trelleborgs of Harry Bluetooth. Many criteria, dimensions, construction of rampart and ditch corresponded to that. But one major criteria, the internal structure of houses and quadrants and the actual streets, was missing. Also, a precise date of the fortress were not known. To solve these problems, the museum were given the opportunity to make a small research excavation in the northwest corner of the fortress. As is evident from the pictures, Nonnebakken has been heavily disturbed, and today the fortress is placed in a densely built up area in the middle of the town. This meant that we had a great deal of skepticism as for the state of preservation. These concerns were not fulfilled. At the place where our excavation took place, the rampart was preserved in a height of minimum 1 meter, and the surface of the fortress were found 2 meters below the present surface. A series of new informations on the site came to light, of which I will present a few here. At the pictures, we see the turf-built rampart placed on a significant leveling layer of yellow clay. Also, the ditch for a series of heavy post holes to support the inner side of the rampart is seen, and a small obliquely placed supporting post hole is seen. At the inner side of the wall, the foundation of an approximately 1.6 meters wide road was found. The construction of the rampart as well as the ring road are well known from the classical trelleborg. What we didn't find were the strict system of axial roads and houses that are so characteristic of Fyrkat, Aggersborg and Trelleborg. In combination with the results from the other excavations at Nonnebakken, we must say that it were never there. The explanation might be found in the presumed short period of use of the trelleborg, some of them never getting into use before the political situation in which they were planned had shifted. Another explanation might be local or regional differences in construction. The new excavation revealed a few spectacular finds. One was a Valkyria fibula found as a stray find from dug up soil just above the surface of the fortress. The fibula is dated to the 9th century. Another spectacular find was a small silver deposit with a bead, a piece of a dirham, and a German coin, a Saxon penny, that dates the deposit. The coin is from 940 to 985. The deposit was found in a small pit in the surface of the fortress. The coin and the new construction details supports the earlier criteria that points to Nonnebakken being, or at least was meant to be, one of our Bluetooth's ring fortresses. Besides that, the Valkyria fibula indicated an older activity. This indication has recently been supported by a series of AMS-datings. A number of these support activities in the period around 980 and until the use of a later monastery in the 12th century. But another series of datings, all from the ring road and the inner wall of a rampart, is dated to the period 595 to 971, and a combined date saying 760 to 780. These dates tells that the fortress was erected already in the 8th century, a period where other fortresses were erected as well, among others St. Albert's at Ærø, but also early parts of Dannevirke, for example. A 3 to 4 small older excavations in Odense pit houses have been excavated. At two of these, Malers and Vestergade, the pit houses had a finds material that pointed to a craft production beyond local usage. In other words, pointing to crafts and trade and maybe a regular marketplace. The excavated areas are lying within a distance of a few hundred meters at a regular plateau. Of course, connecting these features into one unit, a possible marketplace, must be done with great caution. But not taking them into consideration seems to be a bigger problem. From the pit houses at Malers, two new AMS dating supports a canonical date to the 8th to 10th century. At Vestergade, the typological date is around 900. At this location, a series of post holes with early Østersøs ceramics could be from around the same period and could indicate a certain permanence in connection to the possible marketplace, an urban feature that has recently been discussed by Sarah Croix on the Ribe material. The location was formerly thought to belong to an independent village called Hedeby or Heden, mentioned in a document from 1175. Place name studies by Lisbeth E. Christensen has proved that there's little evidence for this conclusion, and that it is more reasonable that Vestergade and Mageløst must be regarded as part of the early Odense. Another example of early permanent settlement is from the oldest layers at the newly excavation at Wilhelm Werner's place in the eastern part of the town center. Here a small handful of houses are AMS dated to the 8th to 10th century. Even though the empirical basis for describing the oldest Odense and its background has considerably improved over the last decade, it still suffers from being dominated by small excavated areas. Despite this, I will in the following try to set up a model for the urbanization process. The first phase dates to the period approximately 750 to 900. Nonnebakken is erected in this period and seems to be related to a proto-city on the other side of the small river Odense. The proto-city includes market activities as well as permanent settled houses. The proto-city covers an area of almost 500.100 meters, which corresponds well with earlier phases of, for example, Ribe and Kaupang. The next phase dates to the period approximately 900 to 1000. Nonnebakken is in this period transformed into one of Harald Bluetooth's ring fortresses and seems still to be related to a proto-city on the other side of Odense. The proto-city includes market activities as well as permanent settled houses. As mentioned, a written sword tells about a church in 988, but the oldest church found, St. Albans, seems to be dated to the 11th century. From 1000 and onwards, the city expands and the finds and features covers larger areas, approximately 700.200 meters. We don't know if Nonnebakken at this time is in use, but the erection of a monastery at Nonnebakken in the 12th century indicates that the land was still owned by the crown. The Church of St. Alban is erected, and in the late 11th century also the Church of St. Canute is erected. The churches and their churchyards gradually take up most of the space in the eastern part of the city, which means that the permanent settlements and market activities moves to other areas. The newly constructed east-west oriented central road, Overgade, Vestergade, seems to become a central organization unit in this movement. To sum up, the research project has revealed that Odense already from 750 to 1000 gradually becomes a city or proto-city. The oldest phase of Odense thereby is much older than the traditional opinion that pointed to a starting point phase of the city in the late 10th century. The place name Odense derives probably from the place name Odinsvi, which might refer to an older heathen cultic place. The placement of the cultic area and later urban activities might be related to the central traffical position. The existence of a cult center might also in itself be an attracting factor. The king and the church later used the old heathen central space as a base of power. Thank you.